Hey GQ, this is Quentin Grimes, and this is The Breakdown. Blue chips. Every video I've seen of Shaq, this is literally how he plays. Every game I've seen him in a Lakers jersey, Heat jersey, like he playing on a mini hoop, like it's not even fair.
All right, there's a thing called Proposition 48, which says that if your grades aren't up to par, you can take the SATs, and if you score 700 or more, you can get into college. Would you be willing to take the test again?
I don't know, man. Them tests are culturally biased.
Well, everything is culturally biased, Leon. I'm just trying to get you in college.
If I couldn't play basketball, would you be trying to get me in college?
No.
If a college really wants you, they'll do anything to, they'll pull every trick out the bag to try to make sure they'll get that kid to come play for that university. Like, somebody else will take the SAT for them, and then know somebody, you just like write their name and have somebody get like a perfect score. I was in Memphis all summer working out pre-draft, and then Penny brought up the story how Shaq wanted him in that movie in Blue Chips, and he saw how good he was, how good he was passing him the ball, and he went back to Orlando, the front office, and said, if y'all don't draft him with the number three pick or first pick, whatever he was, that he's gonna get traded. He's not playing for Orlando anymore. So it's funny just seeing that, how that turned out in that movie, that it happened to be where they met and just ended up in doing big things in Orlando. He got game.
Feel that? Feel the difference?
Now introducing number 34 from Coney Island, Brooklyn, New York, Jesus.
Go to visit any college recruiting. If they really want you like that, they gonna take you to like the main gym, set off all the lights, put like your family pictures with you and your family on the big screen, everything. That's literally how it is.
Telling truth, man.
I hope you don't think we're too forward or aggressive with the highlight film or the jersey.
No way.
That's the way we are here at Tech U. We show love.
Much love, much love.
Why beat around the bush? We've scouted you since you were in junior high school. We know all about you.
He's doing a great job of selling that program to Jesus, because that's like every coach, they're gonna sell you that program. They're gonna crack every joke in the book. They're gonna take you out, be like the best guy ever, your best friend. Then you get to campus, boom, that first practice, they screaming at you, yelling at you, everything. I was at the University of Houston, and I was getting recruited by Coach Sampson. He was just like cracking every joke, trying to show me everything around the whole facility, talking about we got this, we got that. And then the first day, he's yelling at me, putting me on the line. I'm like, dang, what happened to the dude who wanted to be best friends with me? Like, where that dude at? But yeah, college coaches switch up quick because they trying to win games. But I love Coach Sampson. That's my guy. It's crazy how much people want just one person to go to one school, because that kid can bring so much revenue to that university, which is why college athletes get paid now. Sometimes you might get pressure from like those Nike people to like go to a Nike school, or if you play on the Adidas circuit, you might be pressured to go to an Adidas school, because some people might be, you know what I mean, doing some other things to influence you to go to that school. So it's just a lot of different things, different directions people pull you in to make sure that they get paid on the back end. If you go to this school, then he gets a job opportunity. His dad might get a job offer at one school, so now he goes to that school. People will do anything to get one kid just to go to one school, because it could change like the whole landscape of college basketball, which is kind of crazy. Above the rim. I forgot what college came to the game, and I remember I was like, man, I'm gonna try to, I didn't have the offer at the time, and I wanted, they would come to the game to see if they could offer me, and I was just like trying to do everything possible to try to get the offer, let alone knowing I had like the worst game possible. I ended up still getting an offer because I had like, I played good later on, like when they came and saw me later, but like I was just trying to do everything possible. I was trying to shoot every deep three to impress them, trying to dunk everything, missing it, trying to make every flashy pass to impress them, and like literally they just come in there to make, see if you can make the right basketball play. Can you just make an open three? Can you just make the right read off of pick and roll? So like if you just kind of play a simple game, they'll probably love you even more than if you kind of dunking a ball every time or trying to make every deep ball three. So like when you try to impress scouts, you probably gonna end up having a bad game. The air up there.
Yeah, that's a little better. Try not to slap the ball. Try it again with your left hand.
I've heard from numerous players that if they're going to play workout for a team that they didn't like or the city that they didn't like, they're going to be like, man, I'm going to try and have the worst shooting day possible. I'm going to miss every shot on purpose. I'm going to not play hard. I would never do that. I don't know. You tripping. You probably wasting all, you passing up some money doing that. My first offer was from Rice, and it's like super smart school and everything. I was a freshman. I got my first offer. I always kept them in my like top seven, or like my top six, and I would like announce it that like just in case, like, cause I thought it was a big deal for them to offer me, even though I would never go there, just to keep them like in my top seven to like kind of uplift the program, maybe a little bit. A five-star recruit that if somebody might see that if I had them in my top seven, then somebody who was at that caliber to go there, they could go there seeing that I had them in my top seven, kind of being just a high level recruit. So I feel like I kind of owe them, showing them my respect really, just showing that they like, thanks for my first offer, that I'm gonna kind of uplift them a little bit. Sunset Park.
Hey coach, you should play a man on D.
What?
Look at Andre. He wanna be like Mike. Too bad he ain't. Coach, come on, let me play.
Told you, you can't play till you get your stitches out.
Yo, miss, there's a foul, right? Ain't no foul, man. Stop crying.
When you not playing, a lot of things I've been like, knock on wood. I've only been injured like once in college and really my career really. I was out for about like a week. I couldn't practice, so you kind of go to practice, you just watching how everybody does stuff, kind of watching the guy that kind of replaced you, how it would look in that way. And so you just kind of see the game, it slows down a little bit more. You're like, oh, I could have been open right there, hit with a shot right there. I could have made a cut right there, a rebound. So you kind of see the game in like a different way. Then when you get back out there on the court, you're like, oh, I can get a shot. It's easy to shoot the shot right here because he's wide open. So I think when you kind of step back a little bit, it kind of puts you two steps forward when you kind of see the game from a different point of view. If you're playing with a shooter, you got to know, oh, he loves shooting the ball in the corner. I got to make sure I get it to him right away. If he's sprinting really hard to the corner, I'm going to make sure he get it so he in the shot because he gonna feel good. If he scored the ball, I'm going to feel good if I get him an assist. It goes hand in hand. Like, big man, like you got to reward the big man for setting all these screens for me and everything. So if he likes on the left block, I'm going to make sure I get it to him so he can go in there, do something, dunk it, get him going. It's a game. You got to play within the game really to make sure that everybody's successful or happy really, because when everybody's happy, the team's gonna be happy, team's gonna be gelling, team's gonna be winning. For me right now, it kind of tests you to kind of always stay ready. It's kind of a cliche thing to say, just like always be ready. You never know when your number might get called, but that's really how it is. So I gotta go extra harder in practice. Even if I'm not gonna be in that first or second group, I gotta pay even more attention in film because if my name is called, that leash is real short. So I don't have time to go in there and mess up, do things, come out, I can just get pulled like that because like I said, come off the bench now, really in the rotation. So when my number is called, you gotta be over prepared really for when you get in there to make the most of it, where he can keep you out there and keep trusting you, building trust within the coach. It's a different challenge, but I'm enjoying it so far. Hoosiers.
Going for Ray. Now, move!
Come on. Man, my man getting buggies. Let him rock out. Let him do his thing. He gonna get the coach to win. He gonna get him to win. That's all that matters. It's different if he was taking like every shot and missing every shot. You gotta come sit on the bench with me. But if he's scoring every bucket, like he hasn't missed yet, you gotta let him go out there do his thing. That's what a good coach would do. I think that's bad coaching. But yeah, it's time like where coaches or do crazy things just to see how you react, see if he can like, if you're gonna break down, stuff like that all the time. So coaches will play mind games with you all the time. So I feel like it's coaches versus the players sometimes. Coach Carter.
I'm impressed with what you've done, but you came up short. You owe me 80 suicides and 500 push-ups. Please leave my gym.
Hold on, pause. 80 suicides and 500 push-ups? 500 push-ups? I can get through with 500 push-ups. I'm not doing 80 suicides though.
You said we're a team. One person struggles and we all struggle. One player triumphs, we all triumph, right?
If your teammates not helping you out when you're going through something, them not your real teammates, they're not your real friends. Like, it would be time that U of H were like, guy be on the line, he gotta run 2 suicides. And coach say, if he don't make this one, the whole team running. So he got the last 2 suicides he run, we gonna push him through, make sure he run, make sure he get it, cause we gonna make sure we can't run. So we gonna make sure, you gotta make sure your teammates get through. We can't have them hanging out there. Like, college coach, they'll try to break you down, like build you back up. But like with Coach Sampson at U of H, he'll throw 7-8 suicides like in the middle of practice just to like see if you can take it, everything. Like those type times when you kind of going through, like somebody's going through something and you got to pick them up, I feel like that's what makes the team like the closest. When you got to pick them all up, you're gonna see if like your brother's really gonna be with you when it like time gets hard in the game. Like you in practice and coaches yelling at everybody, get on the line, run till y'all pass out, till y'all throw up. That's when like everybody really comes together. So when you in that game and y'all down 4 with like a minute left, y'all gonna find a way to win that game because y'all done been through hell in practice and y'all been in the trenches with them and everything. So I think that's what makes it easier for like a team to have real close, a close bond. Thanks for watching these clips with me. Hope you learned something. See you next time.